We all know the advantages of doing hyperparameter tuning while creating machine learning models. In this video, I aim to walk over every hyperparameter that is possible that you can tune while creating a good, robust decision tree. I hope you all like the video. In this video, we'll explore the most important hyperparameters of decision tree model and how they impact our model in terms of overfitting and underfitting. So let's get started. The first parameter that we'll consider is max underscore depth. Max underscore depth is what the name suggests, the maximum depth that you allow the tree to grow to. The deeper you allow, the more complex your model will become. In the case of training error, it is easy to see what will happen. If you increase the max underscore depth value, training error will always go down. But let's consider the case for testing error. If you set the max underscore depth too high, then the decision tree might simply overfit the training data without capturing the useful patterns as we would like. This will cause the testing error to increase. But if you set it to too low, that is also not good. Then you might be giving the decision tree very little flexibility to capture the patterns and interactions in the training data. This will also cause the testing error to increase, which is a case of underfitting. So you have to find the right max depth using hyperparameter tuning, either grid search or random search, to arrive at the best possible values of max underscore depth. So let's consider the iris dataset. If I decide to grow a decision tree on the iris dataset without keeping an upper threshold level of the max depth, then this is what you will observe. You will see a very large decision tree grown. Chances are that this might overfit your training data and not perform well on your testing data. So this is something that you'll have to avoid. If you do proper hyperparameter tuning and decide to play around with the max depth hyperparameter, then you would reach to something like this. This is a very small decision tree as compared to the one that I showed you previously, where not only does it perform well on the training data set, but it also performs well on the testing data set. So this is how you have to use hyperparameter tuning smartly to reach at the right hyperparameters for your decision tree model. Let's consider the next hyperparameter, that is min underscore samples underscore split. In a decision tree, you have multiple nodes which are there. Some of them are internal nodes and the others are something called as leaf nodes. An internal node will have further splits. So let's now talk about the hyperparameter called as min underscore samples underscore split, which specifies the minimum number of samples required to split an internal node. There are various values that you can enter for this hyperparameter. You can either specify an integer or a number to denote the minimum number of samples you want in an internal node, or a fraction to denote the percentage of samples in an internal node. Let's now consider the next hyperparameter, which is called as min underscore samples underscore leaf. As I've already discussed, a leaf node is a node without any children, so you cannot split a leaf node any further. So min underscore samples underscore leaf is that minimum number of samples that you can specify to term a given node as a leaf node so that you don't want to split it further. Say for example, you start off with 10,000 samples and you reach at a node wherein you just have 100 samples. There is no point in splitting further as you would tend to overfit the training data that you have. So by using this hyperparameter smartly, you can also avoid overfitting. This parameter is similar to min underscore samples underscore splits. However, this describes the minimum number of samples at the leaves, that is the base of the tree. The main difference between the two is that min underscore samples underscore leaf guarantees a minimum number of samples in a leaf, while min underscore samples underscore split can create multiple arbitrary small leaves, though minimum sample split is more common in literature as compared to minimum samples leaf. Let's look at an example. If you set min underscore samples underscore split equal to 5 while creating a decision tree, and if you set min underscore samples underscore leaf equal to 2, and you reach at a node where there are 7 samples at an internal node, then the split is allowed because min underscore samples underscore split is set to 5. But let's say the split produces 2 leaf nodes, one with just 1 sample and the other with 6 samples. Now if you recollect, you have already set the minimum samples you require in a leaf node to be equal to 2, then the split that you were about to make, which was valid for min underscore samples underscore split, which was set to 5, won't be allowed because it violates the second condition that you've kept in your hyperparameter. So this is how you can play smartly to avoid overfitting by playing around with different hyperparameter combinations that are there. Don't worry, you don't have to do any of this manually. You have various techniques like random search and grid search for your rescue. If you are still confused as to how random search and grid search work, then I've created videos on that grounds as well. I'll share the links of both the videos across in the video description. So do have a look. Let's look at the next hyperparameter, which is called as max_features. Max_features represents the number of features to consider when looking for the best split. We can either specify a number to denote the max_features at each split, or a fraction to denote how many percentage or what percentage of features to consider while creating a split. There are various other options available as well. You can use square root, you can use log^2, the total number of features, and you can specify none, that you don't want any of these max_features to come in handy. I want to include all the features at a point. Now, where does this come in handy is, let's take an example. You have a data set containing 50 features and you specify max_feature to be 10. Either using Gini index or entropy to find the best possible split, you randomly go on to select 10 features since you've already defined max_feature as 10, and use them to decide which one of the 10 is the best feature to use. When you go to the next node as well, you would again randomly select 10 features out of a pool of 50 features, and then based on the 10 features, find the best possible feature for the next split. Why is this important? This is important in controlling overfitting. In fact, based on this idea that we have for max_features, this is again extended when we make use of random forest, where random forest adds in two levels of randomization, one at the sample level and the other at the feature level that is there. And next up, we have the hyperparameter called as criterion. So you have an option of growing a decision tree either using Gini impurity or information gain. And thus you have an option to either use Gini or entropy to make or grow your decision tree that is there. Now, which one is better? It again depends on when you create a decision tree using the other set of hyperparameters, which of these hyperparameters, that is either Gini or entropy, gives you a better result with respect to the metric that you're chasing. Either you would want a high AUC ROC value, or you would want a high F1 score, whatever value you're chasing. Based on the different combinations of hyperparameters along with the criterion hyperparameter, you would basically reach to a point wherein you would decide that given this is my data set, these are my hyperparameters, and for this combination of hyperparameters, my Gini index or my entropy is a better hyperparameter as compared to the other one that I'm considering. If you're still confused as to how Gini index and entropy work in creating a decision tree, I've created multiple videos around it, and I'll attach a link to all the videos in the video description. So do have a look. This was my take on the important hyperparameters that you can consider while creating a decision tree. All of this can also be extended for a random forest wherein you will have some more hyperparameters coming in. I hope you found this video informative. If you do have any questions with what we covered in this video, then feel free to ask in the comment section below and I'll do my best to answer those. If you enjoy these tutorials and would like to support them, then the easiest way is to simply like the video and give it a thumbs up. And also, it's a huge help to share these videos with anyone whom you think would find them useful. Please consider clicking the subscribe button to be notified for future videos. And thank you so much for watching the video.